Bonjour. Nem jogavam desde casa. 11 do tempo. Meter. Primeiro estar os ouvindo um. Magai po, po gusto na minguan. Well, sabi ka ay gigito ah. Well, kinamatin sa pentasyon naman. Well, wapos ki ay gajo ni bimit. Well, kakopat siya. Kinawa ba yung matasit. Ito siya ay gigista ko sa ano yun akong asaya mga gigip ni minguan. Ganto asa ako chin pek kami gang. Pwede po kasi na mag away man ito. Sabi wichit. Away. Kaya siya na buwakat. Kaya siya kikendasot. No ay kinamatin. Sabi siya wichit. Sabi saan siya tanamoyt. Away gibito siya naman. Away. Anin. Siya ganaw mandaganis na be. Oye, wapis kaya gajo ni Bimit. Good morning. First of all, I want to acknowledge the ceremony this morning, the pipes, the drums, the feathers, the eagle whistles, and for Robert Matteo Ashing and his wife Mary for taking the lead in that ceremony. I want to thank them for doing that for us. And my name is Robert Green. The name I introduced myself is it's translated as Two Standing Men. I'm named after a spirit that has one foot on the earth and the other foot on the universe. That spirit is standing in two places at once. And I'm from the Midday Lodge. And I'm originally from Shoal Lake, Ontario. And incidentally, I think that water that we're drinking from comes from that source. And I usually tell people that where I come from, also that every summer I go swimming in it. And I also wanted to acknowledge our elders, our leaders, spiritual leaders, our medicine people, our knowledge holders, knowledge keepers, holy people, Ogechita and the Ogechitakwe. And there's so much knowledge here in this room that each and every one of us has come together to help one another, to come together and help each other of what we need to work at. And as I was thinking about doing this teaching about alcohol, I wanted to frame it this way, to come from the Anishinaabe thought and perspective. And in doing so, and in talking about that teaching about that alcohol, I need to talk about it in terms of the past, the present, and the future. Because in the time of our ancient ancestors, alcohol was not anywhere to be found on Turtle Island. Sometimes between 1400s to the 1500s that white explorers came to these lands to find a new world. And one of the first places that they landed was in a place called Churchill, the Nelson River, and the Port Severn River up in northern Ontario. Those nations that were living there, the original nations of the Cree and the Dene, the Inuit, were the first ones to contact, to have contact with these newcomers. And Henry Hudson was one of the original captains that came on that ship there and developed and started to build trading posts in those regions. And slowly they came down those rivers, that river systems, into central Manitoba and central Ontario to do their trading with the First Nations and our peoples. And it was, they found at that time that one of the things, one of the trade items at that time was rum and brandy. And they automatically knew then that the white traders, that our people were defenseless against that substance. And we have a name for that in our language, and that comes from directly from the Creator. Of why we name that, why we have that liquid, that substance in that manner. The way I was describing it, that alcohol in the language, it's called Wapshkiwe Kajo Nibimit. Wapshkiwe means the white people. Kajo Nibimit is the way that substance, that liquid, was given to them. And it was a gift that was given to them by the Creator to help them in their work, where they came from in the European countries. And they, at that time of the fur trade, that item, that alcohol, was a trade item. And right away our people became addicted to that very fast, very quickly. And in the historical records kept by the Hudson Bay Company and the fur traders, said our people that they did not drink alcohol in the way we some social drinkers drink that alcohol. They drink it slowly. They didn't drink it like that. They, what they call now is binge drinking. They drank it, that alcohol, until it was gone. And I did the same thing when I was addicted to alcohol when I was growing up. And same with my parents. I grew up in a family of alcoholics, a community of alcoholics. And a lot of my own relatives have been affected with FASD, FAS, and alcohol-related disorders. So, prior to that, maybe 1,000, close to 2,000 years ago, the Ojibwe Nation was living along the east coast of Canada, what is now Nova Scotia, what is now Quebec, the St. Lawrence area. At that time, that's where the Ojibwe Nation was living, in that territory. Somewhere between 2,000 and 1,000 years ago, these seven spiritual beings, these seven spirits, came from the ocean and delivered a message to our nation. And each prophet delivered a prophecy to our peoples then, and instructed them to migrate inland, because something was coming. They didn't say what at that time, but they knew who it was. It was the white people, the white civilization was coming. That was going to destroy our nation if it wasn't going to move inland, to migrate inland. The Ojibwe nation was given a choice that to migrate inland for a better chance of survival, to survival what was coming then. And each prophet, each spiritual being gave a story, gave a prophecy of what was going to happen to us, to our peoples. And each prophet had a teaching along with that. And now we have, in the Ojibwe history, we have the seven prophecies, and that's where that came from. So here we are now in the territory what was originally the Dakota, Lakota, the Nakota, the Dene, and the Cree. And because of that migration, where we displaced those nations westward, south, and north, and our peoples intermarried with the Crees, and that's where that language, the Oji Cree, came from, because of the combination of those two nations that coming together. So here we are today, looking back on the effects of alcohol in the lives of our communities, in our peoples, and it wasn't always like this. I remember my dad telling us stories that when he was growing up, that during Christmas they would go around visiting houses, go visiting their relatives that lived in that community. And some of the old people, the elders at that time, they used to brew alcohol. And some call it moonshine, some call it homebrew, and various other names. It was a clear white liquid, just like water. And my dad used to tell me that they go visiting around that time, and the elders, those people, would offer a glass of that alcohol. And that's all they would drink, because they controlled it at that time. It wasn't until 1960s when the alcohol was available, because of federal legislation by Canada that alcohol would be open for sale for our peoples, for the Indian people. It did two things, that legislation. It not only opened up sale of alcohol to our peoples, but it also removed our citizenship of who we are then, and also gave us a right to vote. Because prior to 1960, we were citizens of our own nations. And after that, we became citizens of Canada, those ones born after that. So I did those things. And in the summer of 1967, 1968, I remember that was the time of the residential school graduates, I could call them that, reached the age of 16 and they were allowed to come home, and they couldn't go back to school. And it was then alcohol became readily available in the communities. And I remember that one summer, all we ever had that summer was funerals. Almost every week for the entire summer, we had funerals because our people killed each other, died by drowning, house fires, stabbings, and beatings. Because of that, of the effects of the combination of alcohol and the residential school, the effects of trauma, abuse, lateral violence, and the effects of all the abuses that our people suffered in those schools. So there was a combination of that. And I came to find out that through the sacred ceremonies that our people have, that that this liquid, this substance, this alcohol, it's called Wapshki Wega Jolibibit, the alcohol, the water, the liquid that was given to the white people. It's devastated our communities. Even the diseases that came could not match the effects of alcohol in our communities. That one summer that I'm talking about, our population of my community went down by half. At least 50% of that, of our people. Then every year after that, there was more drownings, more beatings, more killings, and the violence never stopped. Even though we don't hear much about it, but it's still there, it's still happening, because alcohol is such a mighty grip on our people that it needs to be paid reverence, and we need to pay respect to it. And that was the only way for me that I was able to overcome my addictions to alcohol. And my dad showed me how to do a ceremony with that alcohol. And he said you don't need a whole bottle. You just need a little bit. Maybe a half an ounce of that. Take it outside. Take your tobacco. Talk to it. Show that you have respect for it. And to expect that respect back from it. And he was telling me that while he was doing that one day, he was outside doing that ceremony that I'm talking about. He knew something was there, but he couldn't see it. He could sense it, he could hear it. It kept moving around all over him. It didn't stay in one place. And that was that alcohol, that whiskey, that liquid, the spirit of that. It has a spirit. It's a very powerful spirit that controls it, that owns that liquid. And that's what we need to teach our young people. To need to teach the mothers and the fathers, the grandparents, that alcohol is a very powerful spirit. And it can also work the other way. It can also help us provide answers for those people affected by alcohol, those people affected by FASD. Because that spirit knows exactly what it has done and what it can do to our people. It can harm us physically, in our minds, hearts, our bodies, and our spirit. All of us, it affects all of our whole entire being. That's how powerful it is. And we need to be very respectful to that. And there was another I combined the two ceremonies together. There was another ceremony that my dad showed me and taught me how to do that in relation to alcohol, was that he took me out to an island. And in that island, there's petroforms or writings on that rock that had always been there. He showed me that spot. He said, right near the edge of that water, you put your tobacco. All along that, the edge of that, where the rock meets the water, right at the edge. And you take your tobacco and make prayers. You talk and speak to that, the Creator. Talk to the water, talk to that tobacco, and talk to whoever is there listening to you, even though you can't see them, and talk to that rock. And finally, you pour that little bit of alcohol along the water and talk to that. Said, please help me so I can help myself to learn to respect you. To have that respectful feelings within myself so I can learn not to take it anymore. Please help me to help myself so I can be a better person, so I can be a better human being, learning to respect the alcohol, that spirit of that alcohol. And shortly after that, I would say within 1 year after that, I began to feel different. I can't describe the feeling, but I certainly felt different. That knowing that my prayers were listened to and answered, and most important of all, the spirit of that alcohol gave me the respect that I needed to show to it. So there lies the answers that we're looking for. And the answers are within our elders, the holy people, the Ogechita, Kwe. And more importantly, the answers are on Mother Earth. All of us, at one time or another, and they're still continuing to be called out to the land, to go out to the forest, to go out to the trees, to go out to the lakes, the rivers, the mountains, the prairies. Even just to sit there for an hour, you'll get that answer. You'll find that answer. Some of our people that go out fasting and vision quest find that answer also. They spend more time there, being out there, 4 days, 7 days, 10 days. And they come back with the answers. I've learned about that, how we can work with that spirit of the alcohol through the elders and through the knowledge keepers and the ones that conduct these sacred ceremonies called the shake tent. And several times I've heard that spirit come in there and giving us the answers, telling us the answers of how we can help our people that have been affected by FASD and how to work with those people. And most important is, even though it's very challenging, the work that needs to be done is they tell us, don't give up. Don't give up hope. There's always hope. There's always an answer that somebody knows, that somebody finds. So it's a combination of our spirituality, our ceremonies, plants, medicines, teachings, and just by being present, just by being there for them, helps them a lot. It helps incredibly just by being there for them and being with them. It helps them more than what we can help them with. Yes, we've been given ceremonies like the purification ceremony, which is called the sweat lodge. We've been given that. And we've been given the what we call the cleansing ceremony. That's the smudge. Those are very helpful as well. And one of the things that each and every one of you can do for yourself, for your family, for your friends and relatives, and those ones affected by FASD, is to take your tobacco, make prayers, make an invocation, talk, speak to the Creator. Because the Creator is very patient. He's waiting for all of us to do that. Very patient, waiting, listening to ask. And we'll get that answers. It comes within 4 days, 10 days, 20 days, a month, or even comes right away sometimes. So those ways are open to each and every one of us. I know the price of this tobacco. Some places it's very expensive, but it's nothing compared to the amount of value that the Creator will give you to help each other, to help yourself, to help those people, and to help one another, to support each other. One of the elders that passed away many years ago gave me this teaching. He said that one day, as you work in the work that you do, he said, as an elder, as a healer, as a helper, some people come to you with nothing because they're so poor, not only in material possessions or money in that way, they're poor in that way, and also poor in that knowledge of knowing what to do. So he said, do not turn them away because they don't have tobacco. They don't have anything to give you. What you do is you get tobacco for them. You get the gifts for them. You get the money and the food for them so that you can help them. Because it's not you that they're coming to see to get the Creator, to get that help. Through you, the word comes through you to interpret, to translate whatever it is that they're going through, what they need help with. So, as our work that, as elders and healers and medicine people, knowledge keepers, holy people, the work that we do is 24/7, 365. And the compensation that we get comes from the Creator. Whatever that you're able to give is good. Whatever you're able to provide to the elder, to the healer, it's good. But the tobacco comes first. That's what's needed to be offered first. And just like that presentation there, that don't be disappointed or don't be insulted if that elder gives that tobacco back to you. Because they may not know, they may not be able to help you, but they can make a referral. Go see this person over here. They will help you. And some of our healers and elders are, they only do diagnosis. They can only diagnose what kind of illness that you have. They may not be able to heal you, but they can make a referral. It's like, go see this one, go see her, and they'll be able to help you in that way. So those answers that we're all looking for is within each and every one of us. And some of us just need to go fast, vision quest, do meditation, deep reflection. The answer will come to you. Comes to each and every one of us. We're all gifted in one way or another. As coming together like this in a group, we all come together to provide that answers, to give each other that help and that answers to all of us. It's like working on a big puzzle. All of us has one piece, and finally when we all put it together, it comes along one big picture. And we have words for the alcohol. Whiskey, for example, we call it Ishkoteawa, which means fire water. And that's exactly what it does. It sets you on fire because of the power and the amount that it carries within that. It has fire and water inside. And there's the other ones that we call Shingobiyawa, Shomenawa. Shomenawa is that wine. Shomen is that grape where that wine came from. So it describes the source of that alcohol, where that alcohol is extracted from those grapes. Shingobiyawa is more like comes from trees, like hops, those kind of natural products that are grown out there. So alcohol is extracted from those sources, and alcohol is derived from that. But the power that it gets from is that spirit. And I cannot emphasize anymore that it's a very powerful, very formidable spirit that we're up against. But we can work with that. We can work with that spirit to help us help our people. All we need to do is ask. I've seen that done before. And we can certainly do it again. And I want to thank each and every one of you. I'm very honored to have been asked to be here. And now I'm Cindy West for listening. You, Edge.